Thanks very much to the Asia Society Policy Institute for this event and what is really a fascinating and actually reads a lot like a courageous report nowadays. And to Ambassador Hockey and the Australian Embassy for hosting us this evening. Last time I was here, and you won't know it from my accent, was to renew my passport. and I think for that reason that those guys in the passport section should get an extra drink at the reception if they're still around. I usually tell the story when I do these things about how when I first took this job writing about trade for the FT in 2013, after a long slog running our foreign desk, Martin Wolf, our chief economics editor, and I went to lunch, and he told me I was nuts. He said there was nothing going on in the world of trade. All the good stuff had happened in the Uruguay round, and he wasn't even really convinced of that. He thought it went back further than that. And he really thought I was committing a bit of career suicide. I revel every time I see Martin nowadays in saying that and remembering that advice to him, because of course things have not turned out that way. I think it's fair to say if you're writing about economics nowadays, there's no single area with more buzz around it than trade. In fact, last night at a reception, I had a former Fed reporter, which I think is a real mark of what he's going through, come up to me and said, "Man, trade is so much more exciting than the Fed nowadays," which is unusual in this town, I should say. And of course, we have the new U.S. president and his trade team to thank for that. In part, for those of you who didn't see Peter Navarro's speech yesterday to the National Association of Business Economists, I highly recommend you go and read it or pick up today's FT and read about it. But really, it is amazing how much things have changed. And as I was walking over here, I was thinking about how much things have changed in the year since you began this project, really. If we think about the TPP, the hopes that came after Atlanta and the conclusion of the deal, the kind of navigating the campaign and so on, and then, of course, the first 6 weeks of this administration, which have taken us in a different direction. But it feels like we've had the storm. There may be more to come. We've had the big debate over globalization. I think one of the great things that this report has managed to do in a short time is really to turn and look forward and to kind of offer some opportunities for the future here. And that's really what we're here to talk about there. So we're going to have a short conversation up here. Then we're going to open it up to the floor because I see some really eminent faces in the crowd and lots of high experts, any of which could be sitting up here and having this conversation. So we'll have a Q&A and look forward to engaging that. But let's start with the conversation here, and let's start with you, Wendy. I think it's fair to say the TPP is at the very least in the deep freezer in the basement of USTR for the time being. And I think really what we're pondering here is what can come next, and what should this administration and how should countries in Asia react? The importance of regional agreements is something that you very courageously stand up for in this.
Well, first of all, thank you very much to you, Shawn, and to the panel for joining the Asia Society Policy Institute's launch of this trade report. A number of commissioners worked on this report. Peter Gray came all the way in from Australia. You look a little jet lagged, so pick it up a little. there are a lot of trade veterans in the audience, and I was extremely honored to serve on a panel with two former trade ambassadors, Mari Pangestu from Indonesia, Greg Domingo from the Philippines, and then a few former ambassadors, Shitaro Oshima from Japan, Chae Suk-young from Korea, and then from Beijing University, Wang Yang. And it was a really good panel, and we really had a lot of fun working together. And we worked hard because we cared about these issues, and we continue to care about them. And Ambassador Hockey, your opening remarks have really made my job easier because you gave a lot of background and context to the world we're facing right now on trade and setting the scene for this report. And we're grateful that you could host us before you tore the building down. And I'd also really like to thank the Heinrich Foundation, which offered generous support for our project. If I could just say a few things about this report, and I think Shawn really described it well. We launched our work a year ago in March, and needless to say, things were very different on the trade front. And at our first meeting, and it's hard to imagine, this was only a year ago, our discussion was all about how we were going to take the TPP and RCEP, kind of work them together and kind of come up with an integrated Asian economy. Needless to say, things have changed since then. Like other reports that have been drafted in this town, we had a pivot after the election. And in that, we continued our thoughtful discussions. We were, obviously, there was a lot of disappointment about the U.S. withdrawal from TPP. A lot of my former commissioners really couldn't understand why we would walk away from a deal that served our national interests so well. And we're frankly a bit perplexed. One of our key recommendations is to ask the administration to reconsider its position. And that's important. But we didn't stop there because we recognize that the prospects of that happening anytime soon are probably close to nil. So what we've recommended with respect to TPP are a few recommendations. One is that the TPP members without the United States look at the possibility of concluding the TPP among themselves, perhaps inviting in others. And next week in Chile, I think that discussion will begin in earnest. We've also urged the TPP standards to stay alive. Don't stay in that freezer, but let's find ways to incorporate them into other areas and through other avenues. And specifically, we think there's room for countries unilaterally to implement some of the reforms called for in TPP. And Vietnam has really been the poster child in doing that. And maybe you, later in the program, could talk a little about what you're doing on the domestic front there. And we've also called for other countries, as they upgrade existing free trade agreements, negotiate new free trade agreements, consider and incorporate the TPP standards. And I think the recently upgraded Australia-Singapore free trade agreement is a really great example where they've actually taken TPP rules and put them into that new bilateral FTA. With respect to RCEP, we had a really interesting discussion on RCEP. I was represented the only country that wasn't part of RCEP, the other six commissioners coming from RCEP countries. And actually, I was trying to put a good face on RCEP and talk about how serious I thought this negotiation was. And I was a bit stunned that the other commissioners were very frank about how the standards of RCEP really need to be elevated over the coming year if this deal was going to be meaningful. And in particular, and this really came from the Philippines and Indonesia, there was a real call that RCEP really focus on provisions affecting and benefiting small and medium-sized enterprises, that there was a huge opportunity here in RCEP, and this would really help step up support for trade. The final area of recommendations had to really do with the whole basket of building support for trade, and we call on domestic policymakers to really look at what they can do in their domestic toolbox to really help those that have been sidelined or left behind by globalization and affected negatively by trade agreements. But we've also asked the multilateral and international economic organizations, including APEC, the G20, and the WTO, all having upcoming summits this year, to really see what they could do in terms of talking about how the benefits of trade can be more effectively communicated. We're not doing a great job in that. We also talked about a lot of these organizations, they're paying a lot of attention to boosting economic growth, and the idea that we put forward, and I think Vietnam's doing a great job on this in APEC, is really working to ensure that growth is inclusive, that it doesn't exacerbate inequalities within societies, but that it really looks to level those inequalities. And finally, we thought that these institutions could provide a really good forum for countries exchanging their experiences in trying to help those affected by globalization. So whether it's an adjustment program, whether it's an apprenticeship program, whether there are certain safety net measures that countries have taken, we think that conversation needs to happen. And if countries can actually share their experiences of policies that have worked or have not worked, we think that can really help move the ball forward. So that's just kind of a snapshot of some of the key recommendations. There are a lot of other recommendations in this report. And of course, I'd urge you all to read it in detail when you have time. But let me stop there and just say that I'm really grateful for all of you turning out this evening. I know a lot of you from years and years of my work at USTR, and it's really a lot of people in this audience that we really need to work together and to try and advance this trade agenda.
Thanks, Wendy. Peter, if I can turn to you as the other co-author on stage, if you will, here, I sort of want to come at you with two parts. One is as a jet lagged Australian, and we've heard from the ambassador the view and the kind of the number of bilaterals and the importance that you attach to RCEP there. I'd love to hear how the view on this kind of looks when you're looking at it. At what was often framed as a geopolitical tussle between China and the U.S. Does it feel like the U.S. is walking away with TPP? And secondly, why the importance of regional agreements, really? I mean, that's, the president now and the current administration argues that bilateral negotiations are just a much more effective instrument to conduct trade policy with.
Thank you very much, Shawn. Maybe I'll start with the last bit about why regional. And it's to some extent influenced by the Australian trade agenda. We've still got a trade agenda when it comes to bilaterals. The ambassador mentioned, Ambassador Hockey mentioned, we're doing one with Indonesia. We've got an ongoing one with India. And there'll be a few more around. But the reality is once we've finished Korea, Japan, China, ASEAN and the ones we're doing now, what do we do next? And in terms of further promoting liberalisation, and the reality is that if you can't do multilateral's obviously the best thing to do, but you can't do it at the moment, just can't. Regional is the one that makes the most sense, and particularly for SMEs. The Australian government's done, I think, a really good job in terms of having online facilities which will help small and medium enterprises navigate all these FTAs and the varying tariff rates and rules of origin and whatever. But nevertheless, it would be an awful lot easier if they just had to go to one website and pick up 12 countries or 16 countries. So there's just a lot of practical reasons why you want to do it on a regional basis. The other element of it is that what Wendy, who led most of this discussion, in her role has done is incorporate something which hasn't done before, which is capture some of the future-looking areas of trade with the chapter on digital trade, e-commerce, picking up SOEs, picking up corruption as an issue in trade, and incorporating them into a trade agreement. I mean, the criticism used to always be of trade negotiators and trade ministers that were always fighting the last fight. You know, we're worrying about tariffs when tariffs were no longer in many parts of the world the major obstacle. Well, the TPP, you finally come up with an agreement which doesn't do that. I mean, it does do that, but it goes further than that. And suddenly it doesn't look like its prospects are fantastic in terms of being implemented. But what I think will happen, as Wendy mentioned, is individual parts of it at the very least will be picked up and used as a model in a range of other trade agreements, the way Australia's put, I think, six chapters into the newly revised Singapore-Australia Free Trade Agreement. So that in itself is a very worthwhile thing, but still not as good as actually having a region-wide agreement. You have to remind me, what was the first question?
The first question was, this. We often talked about the TPP in the context of this geopolitical tussle.
There's certainly an element of that in the sense that the feeling in parts of Asia, I can't speak for Asia and I can't speak for the government, but clearly people like Singapore have been particularly vocal in terms of criticising in advance the concept of US withdrawal from TPP, and Australian government's made it clear that they're not very impressed by that as well. But the it certainly gives a strange signal, and it's a confusing signal. When you've got the United States, which has a fantastic market domestically, it's got a fantastic, the best research base in the world, it's got a growing population, it should be out there being extremely confident, extremely positive. And the sort of the signal you get when you're talking about a retreat from negotiating a TPP or involvement is the US, what's happening in the US? What's happened to the confidence of the United States? It's sort of a strange thing. In terms of bilaterals, and this is where the US has indicated they'd like to take it, the bilaterals may work in some cases for the United States. The trouble is they won't work for the rest of us. And they probably won't always work for the United States. I mean, you don't have to sign onto an FTA. The other party has to sign as well. And so bilaterals are actually a lot harder, and sort of giving up on those ones which you've already got, or giving up a major regional agreement like the TPP, which took years of hard negotiation, compromises on all parts, is frankly, you know, it's difficult to understand why you take that step lightly.
Right.
But I think the bilaterals have got a role, but they have to be balanced, and they have to be ones which achieve their goals, but not at the expense of others.
Right. When I think of bilateral deals, I always think of Jagdish Bhagwati and his noodle bowl. And shortly after I took the job, I made my pilgrimage to New York and had lunch with Jagdish Bhagwati. And sure enough, we had noodles. And I always thought of you know, okay, if the multilateral bit isn't working, we're resigned to the noodle bowl. But at least the TPP and TTIP and those were kind of the ravioli plate that was kind of coming along. And then someday you would get the great, you know, multilateral lasagna, I guess, is the way of thinking about it. Ambassador, and I always thought of South Korea as really as one of the leading candidates, or one of the leading countries that was always going to join the TPP in that next round. And I know you had a big domestic debate about that. You're also involved in RCEP. I'm just curious as to what you see as the way forward now from Seoul and in terms of participating in this economic integration. Are you fully into RCEP? Are you hoping for a revival of TPP? Mm-hmm. Is there something else?
Right. Well, Shawn, thank you so much. Well, I think I should be beginning my usual caveat, which is that I'm here maybe as a former trade official rather than as present ambassador of Korea representing Korea to the United States of America. So that, in fact, is the usual caveat. And then having said that, when it comes to TPP, then I think our plan A was definitely this, which is that we missed out in the first wagon, but at the same time, definitely we were thinking about joining it in the second wagon. So to paraphrase it a little bit, what we thought was, we already expressed our interest in TPP. That happened in November 2013, and then what has been advised to Korea was this, which is the thank you for your interest, but at the same time, the train is already off. So once we are done among 12 of us, then you will be very welcome to come and join us. So I have to be frank with you in the sense that when the negotiation was wrapped up among the 12, then I was very glad. Why? Because I said to myself, my turn, our turn will be coming soon. So that was plan A. But now we know that we should be moving on to plan B. And then that, in fact, is exactly the reason why I was so glad when I came across this report coming from Asia Society, in the sense that, well, Wendy was so kind enough in order to go through several points which were included in recommendation. By the way, I, in fact, liked all the recommendations, but at the same time, I liked the recommendation on TPP best. Mm. Because, well, just because I loved it so much, let me just repeat it once again, even if Wendy has already done. And then what it said was that, well, if it is the case that not all 12 countries can join the TPP, then why not let it just go into force among 11 countries? That is recommendation number one. Number two, well, if there is not sufficient trade creating effect, why not invite other countries to come and join TPP? That's the second piece of recommendation.
That was your favorite.
That is my favorite, obviously. That's my favorite, obviously. And then the third and then most important and the most interesting piece of recommendation was, of course, well, okay, let us just move a little bit back about entry into force among 11 countries or how many countries. But at the same time, whatever happens, well, it was state-of-art agreement. TPP was a state-of-art agreement. So why don't you use it as a template for any trading arrangement, bilateral, regional, plurilateral, whatever, why don't you use it as a template? There were the three recommendations included in the Asia Society report, and I love them. And then that's Plan B, and Plan B, I really love them.
Okay.
But at the same time, Shawn, if you allow me, can I make one additional point?
Of course.
That is, well, as a matter of fact, this, in fact, is not obviously, well, explicitly pointed out in the Asia Society report. But at the same time, well, we hear so many things about international trade in this town these days, not only in this town, but across the whole world. And then if you ask me what, in fact, would be the most important one single recommendation you should be making, then my answer would be this, which is that let us reaffirm our commitment to rule of law. Let us reaffirm our commitment to rule of law. Mm. Why do I say that? It's because Ambassador Hawke of Australia, not only being a host this evening, but at the same time, I really, really appreciated your opening statement because one of the things you said was a football analogy. And in the middle of football, you don't change the rule. If you change the rule in the middle of the game, it will get nowhere. It will be chaos, confusion, conflict. It will go nowhere. That's what you said. And I really loved it. I loved every part of your opening statement. but at the same time, I loved that analogy best. Why? Because these days I'm concerned. Because so many people are saying, well, if you don't like WTO, if you don't like the decision by the WTO, forget it. Right? And then that, in fact, is the most worrisome statement I ever hear. Because let us just think about the meaning of the past 70 years we lived through after World War II. And then let's just admit it in the sense that, yes, it was not perfect. But at the same time, if you just put this 70 year against 5,000 of human history, then it was a unique period of relative peace, relative prosperity, and then relative, in fact, happiness. That, in fact, is the meaning of the past 70 years. And then how was it possible? I think one large reason why it was possible was because of the leadership role played by the United States. And that leadership was so important. Why? Because it was based upon universally applicable set of values like human rights, liberal democracy, market economy, transparency, and rule of law. And entering the 21st century, this is my observation. You may not agree with me, Shawn, but this has been my observation. Somehow, it is not small countries entering the 21st century. Somehow, it was larger countries, which is poo-pooing rule of law.
Yeah.
And that worries me. And then, as a matter of fact, so far, saving grace has been, United States has been steadfastly behind rule of law, not only domestically, but internationally. And then I'm definitely of the view that when somebody says, well, United States does not support the rule of law in the international community, I think that must be a fake news. So if there is one single recommendation, which I would emphasize, well, emphatically, that would be reaffirming our attachment to rule of law. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, it matters very little whether I agree with you or not, Ambassador. I happen to agree with you, but there's a man at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue who has a tent, you know, who's surrounded by people who have a different view of the international system.
No, Sean, that's what I'm telling you. Yeah, that's fake news. That's
We're starting to get confused with all this fake news mentions here. What do we believe anymore? The Ambassador, Vietnam
has been universally praised here today. I mean, really, you are so far the stars of the show, as far as I can tell. But you also were stood to be one of the biggest beneficiaries of the TPP, clearly. I think a lot of the economic modeling that we saw showed that really Vietnam, this was going to be a huge gain for your economy. We also saw an influx of Chinese investment looking to take advantage of the TPP and other FDI and so on. Now that that TPP is off the table for now, at least, I mean, what do you see as the future for you? And
thank you very much. First of all, I want to say and thank you very much for the ambassador from Australia to raise me to that international front. And actually, 30 years ago, I was studying in Australia in the Canberra College of Advanced Education at the point in time. So thank you very much. I have connections personally also, not just between the two nations. But come back to the TPP issue, we mentioned that Vietnam is beneficial. There has been a lot of calculations and analysis, but the TPP is not there yet. But we know how much difficulty we have overcome in order to be part of the TPP. I must tell you, and the ambassador of Australia has mentioned it very correctly, that we look to the TPP, number one, it will create an environment and a space for trade, and we are pro-trade. And we progress also. And if that one, that will help us also to be part of the global value chain and supply chain, and we can do better for our economy and also for our trade. Point number two, we know that nowadays, if we stay low, then it's very much difficult to go to the next stage of our economic development. So we need to go to the standards that set in the TPP, and we look around inside our countries, there have been a lot of difficulties in terms of economic, in terms of structure, and also institutional as well. So we feel very much difficult at first, but we need a political decision and commitment, and at the same time, we have to work with the domestic business community and the population. And you know that after a few years of negotiations, the business community in Vietnam, they are for the TPP 89%. And the people is around 80%. Because they look forward, number one, a more space for economic activities and trade activities. And number two, to look into the policies of the government of Vietnam for further reforms. This is what they understand, that for the TPP, you will have to reform back home while you expand trade and economic activities there. Now, with regard to the TPP now, I very much agree with Ambassador Ahn on the point relating to the analysis of the report and also the key findings and recommendations of the report. The standards of the TPP has been achieved through very hard work and to us in Vietnam, we consider it's a balanced one. It's a win-win solution, a trade agreement that we can have. So it need to be, in the words of Ambassador Ahn, need to be a reference or a template for future negotiations on trade. Certainly, it will be a, what do you call it, state-of-the-art. Agreement. So it needs to be there as a template or model or reference. But for us, Vietnam, we know that in order to move up our economy and to attract the business community to invest in Vietnam and to do business in Vietnam, we will put the key elements of our commitments to FTAs, like the FTA with Korea is a high standard one. Like the FTA with the European Union is also a high standard one, and the key elements are similar to those in the TPP. Those will be put into the national reform package, and we'll continue to do that. And we have been talking to the business community here in the US, and I think that we got a lot of encouragement by the business community here if we keep on our reform in that direction, and that will help both of us. And I think that the business we will create a fair business environment in Vietnam for the U.S. investors and so on.
Okay. Have you been approached by the Trump administration about a bilateral deal?
We have not, but we have the leaders of Vietnam have some contacts with the new administration. For example, my prime minister has a phone call with him. But actually, for myself as ambassador, I've been around with some of the members of the new team. And I think that, number one, we are very much having a desire to strengthen further our relationship, our comprehensive partnership in all areas. And point number two, we are open to a framework to strengthen further our relationship, including in the economic areas.
So do you expect to be negotiating a bilateral deal soon?
We have to ask the other side. But we are open, and yeah. I think that trade and economic cooperation has been a pillar over the past 20 years when we have diplomatic relations, and that will be very much important in our relationship. So we will...
I'm intrigued by something Wendy said very early on about you being the kind of RCEP booster on the panel or the task force. I wonder, ambassadors, do you think as you both are in countries involved, and maybe I'll ask you, Ambassador Hockey, as well, but countries involved in RCEP negotiations, do you think we'll see a deal by the end of this year?
Well, can you start with alphabetical order?
I think on A is, I think that makes you
Australia.
I'm not the moderator, but can I rephrase that question?
Okay, sure.
Do you think we'll see a meaningful deal?
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I think, based on the discussions we had in the commission, I think there was a view among everyone that there may be a lot of pressure to do the deal,
right,
particularly given it's ASEAN's 50th anniversary, and that come November they'll really want to announce something. Mm. But I think what the commissioners really felt was that we really need to press our own governments to really work hard to really elevate right. the standards of RCEP so we can announce a meaningful deal.
Right. Ambassador, do you think we'll have a meaningful deal by the end of this year?
I've been out of the country for more than 2 years now. But I believe that for me, the RCEP we create a space for trade within the region. And we have already in place ASEAN plus Australia, New Zealand, ASEAN plus China, Japan, India, Korea, all the six partners of ASEAN. We have an FTA already. So there's some basis for us to move further forward in connecting all these bilateral FTAs between ASEAN and the dialogue partners. And point number two, they are focusing on the aim to have it by this year. But certainly it depends on the negotiators. But point number three, because things are developing throughout the world, especially in the Asia and Pacific, and in order to keep Asia Pacific as a region of dynamic development and also an engine for the world economic growth.
Right.
You need to think of the recommendations from the Commission's report that taking here and there the high standards of the FTAs that have already been in place or the key elements in the TPP as a reference right. if it suits the countries in the region. But I think, I very much hope that they will move as fast as possible. But trade and economic negotiations will always be difficult.
There's certainly plenty of text to copy and paste. Peter, I'm curious, as someone who spent time at the WTO, I was talking to someone who, like you, is a veteran of WTO scene the other day, and they were talking about RCEP and saying, and kind of laughing a little bit, saying the ideas of the Indians and the Chinese negotiating with each other, and this was someone who had negotiating with both sides at the WTO, was seeing this as a kind of an interesting prospect, I think.
I think it's probably right. It is yeah. prospect, but I mean that's. I think it's too early to tell how that's going to come out. I think, frankly, in some ways you're better off. Feel more happier, more confident about it if they weren't setting a deadline of this year. So sometimes these things need a bit of time to get there, and you really don't want to rush them into that sort of situation. But I think it does show one interesting point, which goes back to what you talked about earlier, Shawn, in terms of the strategic dimensions to all of this, that in the absence of a TPP, the world's not going to stay still. Right. So certainly in the Asian region, my old department, Foreign Affairs and Trade, actually had some interesting maps where they had all those concentric circles showing who was in and who was out of each arrangement. And it's interesting, and also on a time series, so going back to about 2000, and it is quite remarkable, actually, when you look at the extent of the degree of integration and attempts at regional economic architecture which have taken place over the last 15 years, starting from next to nothing. It's actually quite a dense process of negotiation, consultation, and enhanced bilateral relationships. So I think that's all good stuff. Can I go back to one point which Wendy mentioned at the outset, which is in the report, which talks about the fact that we've all failed as negotiators, as political leaders and whatever, in selling the benefits of trade. And you, Shawn, I have to say, mentioned the dreaded two words, economic modelling.
Yeah.
Because as soon as you say that the agreement has, you know, leads to an increase of 0.245% over the next 10 years, or 350
billion. I had people at USTR telling me that was huge. You know,
well, it is huge. It is huge. But to the average household, does it really mean very much? Yeah. I mean, it means a lot. I think what we've done is, and this is true, I think, in an Australian context, Best Hockey might have a different view on it, but we've certainly got the business community in Australia is certainly strongly supportive of free trade agreements and trade liberalisation, which wasn't the case maybe 30 years ago. But I don't think we've, you know, even in an Australian context, have completely sold the population as a whole on it, and partly because, and this has been the case ever since trade has existed, people, the individual sees the negative side of it before they see the positive side of it. But, I mean, there's a good example in an Australian context which illustrates how far a country like Australia has come. If you went back to the time, the start of the Uruguay round, say, take 1990, if you wanted a motor vehicle, an auto in Australia, an imported one, you paid, there were quotas on it for a start, and you paid 55% duty. Now, if the government decided to, let's go back to the future, we'll readopt a 1990 trade policy in Australia, and you had to stand up there and announce that we were going to increase the price of imported motor vehicles by 55%, I suspect there'd be a few upset consumers. And when they go into their local Kmart or Target or whatever to buy clothes, and which used to have quotas on them again and tariffs were up to 100%, and then suddenly the clothes are now 100% more expensive, I suspect the average punter out there would be quite upset about that. So I think there are ways, and they're peculiar to each country. You can't set out in a report like this, and you can't set out in a Geneva context what the benefits of trade liberalisation are in a way which is really meaningful to individuals out there working hard.
Yeah.
And I think in a sense TPP is a bit unlucky in that it's at the end of a cycle where the support for trade liberalisation, I think, in the United States, but also in other countries, has become much more challenging.
Yeah.
Well, Shawn?
Yeah?
Well, so that I wouldn't give you the impression that I'm just avoiding the question.
Okay.
I mean, if ASEAN would be over by the end of the year. I just listened to your question, and then I just listened to three panelists, and then the idea which comes up in my mind is one word, which is trade-off relationship, which is that, well, let us just think about the level of ambition that we are going to achieve through whatever negotiation it may be. And then in this particular case, it will be RCEP. But whatever negotiation it may be, there is always trade-off relationship between level of ambition and time. And then something negotiators say all the time is this, which is that, well, if we have to make a trade-off, then we will go for the quality rather than time. So maybe we could say the same thing in this particular context as well. But at the same time, I was just listening to Ambassador Gray, and then I think Ambassador Gray is getting at another trade-off relationship, which is the number of negotiating countries and the easiness of negotiation.
Right.
There can be trade-off relationship as well. And then this gets back to your point about Bhagwati's spaghetti bowl or lasagna bowl, and definitely we prefer lasagna bowl. And then the thing is, in order to get a lasagna rather than spaghetti, then of course we better have sufficiently large number of participants in the negotiation. But the problem is the larger the number of participants, the more sophisticated and difficult it becomes.
Right.
And then what do you need, you know, to get the best of both worlds? That is to say, make it larger, but at the same time, reach high level of ambition. What do you need, you know, to reach there? I think what you need, you know, to do it, that is, again, leadership.
Yeah.
And why TPP was successful when it was among 12 countries, and then economies, most highly advanced economies in the whole world, and then not so highly advanced economies in the whole world. But at the same time, at the end of the day, they could get together. They could come up with a very high-level negotiation agreement. Why was it possible? Again, I think it was because of the United States. And then let us just look at RCEP. Who would be playing the role of the United States? Again, I told you, if there is one thing which is most important in today's world, that should be reaffirmation of rule of law, and then reaffirmation of who should be standing behind that rule of law. That is, again, the importance of leadership role of the United States.
Right. I mean, the assumption is that China will play that leadership role. Are you comfortable with China playing that leadership role?
Well, as a matter of fact, let us just think about it in the sense that, well, United States, in my mind, is a unique country. Unique not only in today's world, but unique in human history, in my mind. Because a large hegemon country, consistently supportive of universally applicable sets of values. Let us just think about historical examples. Let us just think about examples in today's world. I find it extremely difficult to come up with an example, either historically or in today's world. So rather than making any comment upon what China could do or could not do, let me emphasize once again about this very uniquely important role which United States has played for the past 70 years, but which it must continue to play for the coming 70 years and beyond.
Okay. What about you? Are you comfortable with the idea of China leading, as this leading advocate of free trade in the region?
Actually, the RCEP is different. The starting point of it
was
assumed that ASEAN would be playing the central role. And ASEAN is connecting the dialogue partners. And I think that so ASEAN, in order to play that role, it need to work with the dialogue partners.
Right.
So RCEP is different.
Yeah, it's different. But we've seen clearly Xi Jinping go to Davos. That was quite a moment. I was at APEC in Lima immediately after the election, where I watched the same performance by Xi Jinping. Really an astonishing moment, and lots of standing ovations from people in the audience who may or may not have been planted there. But this is a fascinating moment right now, where we're seeing China assert itself as the free trade leader.
Each country has a role to play. And I come back to the issue that Ambassador Ahn just mentioned, is that for the last 70 years after World War II, we have a set of rules and international order. And that need to be followed. Everyone need to be based on that. So who volunteer to lead in one way or the other, but across the board, that will be rule of law.
Yeah. I want to come back to the point that Peter was making about consumers and the selling of trade and so on. And I'm torn on this one right now, because we clearly see this. It feels to me like the tussle between national identity and my grandfather in Sydney, who lived in Concord, was a Holden man and through and through, and wouldn't even buy a Ford, you know, so let alone a Toyota. And we see that same thing here in the U.S. with the resurgence of the Buy American campaigns that we've seen, and those are a revisiting of the 80s, it feels like to me, and the campaigns we saw then, whether you're Chevy or Ford man, et cetera. But then at the same time, we have this kind of consumer dynamic there, that the consumer prices dynamic. And I thought Sean Spicer did more for free trade on Air Force One a few weeks ago when he raised the idea of this border adjustability tax, a
20% tax paying for the wall along the Mexican border. And immediately Lindsey Graham responded by saying anything that raises the price of tequila, beer, or margaritas is a terrible idea. Mucho sad in a tweet. And we then had a weekend, what felt like a weekend of, I'd never seen so many avocado stories in the U.S. press, and of course all those ads we saw during the Super Bowl for avocados from Mexico, which were really talking about that consumer point there. I mean, I wonder that kind of tussle between national identity and kind of consumer desires or serving the consumers. Where are we falling on this one, Wendy?
I think that's a great question, and I'm always intrigued when I read polls of Americans. On one hand, they say they're willing to pay, you know, higher prices if they could have their jobs. If the question's asked differently, having lower prices for consumer goods is the most important thing. So I think it's a really complex question. It depends where you sit, and it depends what your experience is. If you feel like you're being left behind by globalization, then if you're asked, well, you know, are lower prices worth it? If it means your wages have to go down, it's a hard question to answer. I think the answer is no. I'd rather have a high-paying job. But I think when you raise the Toyota issue, just one thing that comes to my mind, it's such a different world now than it was in the 80s. Because we have so much foreign investment here, foreign companies from Korea, from Japan, increasingly from Vietnam and others. And they're really creating jobs here, and they're the ones who are going to Trump Tower explaining everything they're doing, and if anything, expanding their facilities
here. But at the same time, if Peter Navarro was here, and I'm going to channel him briefly here, but he would argue that part of the reason we have had that foreign direct investment is because of the trade battles fought in the 1980s and some of the barriers that were put up then that encouraged Toyota and Korean automakers to locate plants in the U.S.
And I don't doubt that was part of it, but it was also, you know, there's something about proximity to the consumer. When you look to make foreign investments, you look at their FTA arrangements with other countries and how you could tap into that network. And so I think there are a lot of different considerations that are made.
Yeah, can I quickly interject now? I mean, you have to ask the question. I was struck in Australia. You talked about used to be two car makers, four went down to three, and now down to not very many at all at this point in time. But if you look at the top, if you looked in the mid 80s, the top car makers, they're General Motors and Ford. There's no question. People would have thought that would go on forever.
But it was General Motors with a local brand, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But now you look at it, and I saw a recent thing. I'm not sure whether either of those two are in the top 10 in makes of cars in Australia.
Interesting. Yeah.
And I think you'll find that, you know, you have to ask yourself, and I don't know the answer to this. I mean, why is it that that General Motors and Ford are not in the top two car makers globally? Why is it Toyota and why is it VWs? Because if the line of argument which you're putting, which I don't know is correct or not, Peter Navarro, then why is Toyota globally the number one maker?
Yeah,
I mean it doesn't make any sense. I mean you'd expect after the end of those policies would be General Motors or Ford should be the number one globally, yeah. But they're not.
I remember being struck, and this is an aside, but going to Central Australia in the 1990s to visit some Aboriginal communities and imagining a land that would have been full of Land Rovers at one point, British makes, and you go out to the Aboriginal communities, and they don't call them four-wheel drives, they call them Toyotas. And there are all these Toyota troop carriers with twin tanks that have these amazing ranges and so on. And it's an amazing testament to the kind of power of quality in some ways, or the ricketiness of Land Rovers, if you've got one of those. We're going to go to the audience very quickly.